What is that next point? Degeneracy of the gametes. So what is actually this point taking? Say, for example, if an amino has only tryptophan and methionine are specified by a single codon, UGG for tryptophan and AUG for methionine. These are the only two specific amino acids which have actually the separate, or the remaining will can code for the different amino acid. I mean, the same amino acid can code for two different amino acid. What is the next point under? All the other amino acids are specified or coded. As I have already told, each codon can code for more than 2 to 6 amino acids. Leucine, serine, serine, and arginine are the three amino acids are coded by specified by coded or specified by 6 codons. So this is what we have to understand. And degeneracy is related to the third. Yeah, I think this you have to concentrate more, because wobble hypothesis is important for NEET point of view. They generally don't ask this wobble hypothesis for CET, but it is mainly a NEET concept. What is wobble hypothesis? So for example, a third position, say for example, there is A, U, G. If A and U, sorry, for example, there are, say I'm calling it as 3, amino acid 1, amino acid 2, and amino acid 3. If this two amino acid has the degeneracy property, even this amino acid will have it, it will be described as a wobble base, and that the hypothesis we call it as wobble hypothesis. And the next one, it is the Human Genome Project. Before going with this Human Genome Project, I hope it is genetic code is clear for all of you. If it is perfect, please reply in the chat section. We'll start with the Human Genome Project. Human Genome Project is basically the mega project which what is the main aim of this Human Genome Project? This Human Genome Project, the main area of this Human Genome Project was to identify all the genes, to identify all the genes present in the human beings, and to give the detailed explanation about that. So that is what the term genome has been introduced. So basically, what is genome? It is the entire set of genes. Say for example, one cell has 23 chromosomes, 23 pairs of chromosomes. Like that, each 23 pairs of chromosomes will be having so millions of genes. And the main aim of this project was to explain the entire set of genes in the entire set of collected genes in the neat database fashion. So next, genomics is the sub-discipline. We'll just go forward. Yes, structural genomics, which helps to deal with the structural, the sequence. Say for example, AUG, UGU, like that, the structural genomics. And the functional genomics, say for example, AUG, what it is helping for, UAG, what it is helping for. All these things will be studied in the structural and the functional genomics. I think proteome and all, it will be the two difficult, it's the way more a deeper concept, but you have to understand this word proteome, but that is fine. And next, genomics and Human Genome Project. See, the Human Genome Project, sometimes called as biology's moonshot, was launched on October 1st, 1990 for sequencing the entire human genome of 2.75 billion nucleotide pairs. You have to concentrate on this. There is this 2.75 billion nucleotide pairs. We have all the nucleotide pairs. Next one, it is human. These are the two important associated are Francis Collins, who is a director of the Human Genome Project, and J. Craig Venter, who is the founding president of the Celera Genomics. So these are the two main scientists who associated for this Human Genome Project. The complete sequencing of the first human chromosome, small chromosome 22, was published on December 1999. The dates might not be important, but which chromosome number is very important. It is chromosome number 22, which is the smallest chromosome, has was first completely sequenced. Yeah, I think this is the table that gives you the number of base and the number of base pairs and the number of genes in the different kinds of organisms. But you have to mainly concentrate on this Drosophila melanogaster, because Drosophila melanogaster is called a central of genetics, because in the various experiments of genetics we use this Drosophila melanogaster. And you have to also remember about bacteriophage, which has around 10,000 number of base pairs. Apart from that, human, it is 2.75 billion, approximately 3 billion that is already known. So we'll go to the next one. Prospects and the implications of human genome. Under that, if I'm specifically calling the disease as HIV, if I study the entire applications of all the genes, entire morphology and entire biochemical composition of the genes, I'll get to know how to cure the disease. So that was the main aim of this human genome project, to cure all sort of diseases. They did this human genome project. Next, efforts in progress of determine genes that will work. Say for example, if cancerous cells are there, how to prevent that? Which gene in the human body is actually causing this cancer? Now you tell me, which genes will cause cancer? Which genes will cause cancer? Yes, it is oncogenes. That is correct. And there is this one more gene called as proto-oncogenes. This proto-oncogenes undergo mutation, and that mutated will be this oncogene. That's correct. The human genome sequencing not holds promise for healthier living. That is obviously correct. The main aim was to collect the entire information in a database, that is in a computerized system, and one can cure any kind of disease. That was the main aim. After that, we have DNA fingerprinting. You have to please remember the scientist's name called as Alec Jeffries. Very important, mark it as a very important question for CET. Alec Jeffries is one scientist who actually started this DNA fingerprinting. We'll not go much deeper into this DNA fingerprinting, because as you've already learned, DNA fingerprinting, it is the way more interesting concept to it. It will help to find out the victim under the murder cases or at the rape cases. I think under any sample, they can do this DNA fingerprinting. What you have to mainly understand in DNA fingerprinting is that VNTR abbreviation, that is actually helping. That is, how do we abbreviate VNTR? You please leave an answer in the chat section. VNTR, how do we abbreviate it? I think you have to just remember that. It is also known as DNA profiling. Please mark it as very important. Again, we have got a question in this. DNA fingerprinting, it is also called as DNA profiling. Okay, and I didn't get the answer for VNTR. Please answer it in the chat section. Yes, it is the variable number of tandem repeats. Variable number of tandem repeats, that is correct. So for example, what is happening? There is any doubt if a person is doubtful, if the sample is matching the DNA coding, say for example, if it runs DNA A, DNA session, section A, section B, section C, and section D, and section A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D. It is matched. So that is what, that is how we explain this DNA fingerprinting. Yeah, mini satellites. Here we have variable number of tandem repeats. Actually, this is helping out to explain the DNA fingerprinting. Technique of DNA fingerprinting, as I have already told, any sample is fine. In skin cells, any sample is taken for the DNA fingerprinting, and typically DNA content of about one blood cells or about 1 microgram is sufficient. All these are the way more different ones. You don't have the process to study, but you have to study about polymerase chain reaction. But again, we will be discussing the same in biotechnology chapter. So I think we'll discuss at that time. Polymerase chain reaction we will be discussing at the time of biotechnology chapter also. So let me, the procedure of DNA fingerprinting, DNA, it is cut into the fragmentation. Then I think all this we get to discuss one more time in the biotechnology chapter. So let me discuss at that time. And and when it comes to the application of DNA fingerprinting, this is the major area that you have to concentrate. Identify criminals. So that is, as I have told, it is important in the forensic laboratories. Settle paternity disputes. Say, for example, if any of the babies exchanged as soon as after the birth, if the parent doubts that it's not their baby, I think it will settle the paternity disputes. And with respect to paternity disputes, again, you have to again go with this ancestral property fights. All these things will be settled there. Verify whether a hopeful immigrant is a close relative of an already established. I think this is all, you can just read that. Identify racial groups to rewrite biological evolution. This is one of the major and the interesting thing. Evolution explanation is mainly done on this DNA fingerprinting. Yes, sir. So now you please have to tell me if you have any doubts. I'll clarify now. I'm just unmuting everyone now. So you can please ask if you have any doubts. And at the same time, I want all of your videos to be enabled. Can you please do it now? All of you please enable the video. I hope I'm audible to all of you. I want all of you to enable. And do not mute. If you have any doubts, you can please ask me now before getting to this question and answer session. Deepak, Archana, even I want all of you to enable your video. There's one more screen. Varsha, Ayman, Sahana D667 and gmail.com and Gangadhar Ramesh. Please do not mute. Now you please ask me if you have any doubts regarding the synopsis that I have explained. Doubts at least. You have to please reply, or else I think we can start the question and answer session. We are running out of time already. Do you have any doubts? Okay, Deepak has replied. He don't have any doubts. Jeevan has replied. Varsha has replied. Sadhran blotting, yes, I'll explain that. After that, so all of you are sure that you don't have any doubts or you don't have any things to clarify. Yes. Okay. There's one student who has doubt in the Sadhran blotting. Let me explain Sadhran blotting. So what is Sadharan blotting? It is, say, for example, if I give you a DNA, you must be able to identify, say, for example, I just give you a DNA. What do you, what you are supposed to do with that kind, what with that DNA? Say, I give you the DNA, you have to identify the sequence of that DNA. That is done by the DNA hybridization technique. That process, we call it as Sadharan blotting. That I think you will get a detailed explanation under biotechnology chapter, because we have to study Sadharan blotting, Northern blotting and Western blotting. Apart from that, there's no other doubts to anyone. Okay, let me ask for one last time. If you have any doubts, you can please ask me now. Or if you don't have any doubts, you please reply for one more time that you don't have any doubts. We'll start with a question and answer session. I have got only one reply. Please make it as soon as possible. Yes. Shall we start the question and answer session then? Yes. We'll start with the question and answer session. I think all of you have to unmute now. Please be interactive. It's just like one-sided. I want all of you to be interactive. I want all of you to speak up this time. You're not supposed to leave a message in the chat section. I want all of you to answer for the question. We'll start with the first question. Please unmute. I'm unmuting everyone. Don't mute. Yeah. The first one I have already told at the end, starting of the synopsis. The process through which the amount of DNA, RNA, and protein can be known at a time. So simultaneously, you should know all the composition. How much amount of DNA is there? How much amount of RNA is there? How much amount of protein is there? So which is the correct option? We start with
autoradiography.
Yes, sir. We'll check which is the correct option now. Or there is this option called as autoradiography, tissue culture, cellular fractioning, phase contrast microscopy. So let me start with option 4. Now, is the phase contrast microscopy is a correct answer? Definitely it is not a correct answer. Why? Because it is just a microscope to visualize the image. So this microscopy has no role in finding out the amount of DNA, RNA and protein. So I think we can omit that, or we can delete that option D. Cellular fractioning. What is cellular fractioning? Say, for example, I'll give you two different kinds of cells which vary in the density. Say one cell has one cell is much denser than the other cell. Fractioning will separate the cells based on the density. Again, I think we don't have anything to do with the cellular fractioning to the amount of DNA, RNA, and protein. Tissue culture is nowhere related to DNA, RNA, and protein. And the right answer is autoradiography. How it is the correct answer? I think all of you can just read this. I want all of you to please read. Autoradiography is the use of X-ray films. Go back to the Watson and Crick model of DNA now, which I have explained in the synopsis. I already told Watson and Crick used autoradiography, and Rosalind and Franklin used X-ray crystallography. I'm specifying this word, autoradiography and X-ray crystallography. So these are the two. Bandito Lydia. Okay. So autoradiography and X-ray crystallography are the two main techniques which generally helps in the finding out the exact amount of DNA, RNA, and protein. We also have this next point. I think this point will be more clear for all of you. So typically, biomolecules are labeled with 32 phosphorus and 35 sulfur. So now you please, you have to speak up. So phosphorus is present in protein or DNA and sulfur is present in protein or DNA. Now you tell me, phosphorus present in DNA or protein? You have to speak up, please. Phosphorus is present in DNA, that is the radioactive phosphorus is present in DNA. Phosphorus is present in DNA or protein. Very good. Phosphorus is present in DNA and sulfur is present in protein. So I think based on the protein and sulfur composition, the the amount of DNA, RNA and protein will be estimated. Yes, autoradiography technique. We'll go with the second question. See, Balbiani rings are found in polysome, polytene chromosomes, autosomes, nonsense chromosomes. So now you have to please tell me, how many of you have idea about Balbiani rings? I hope everyone will be interactive in the session, question and answer session. Okay, do you know what is Balbiani rings at least? Say at least yes or no. Okay, let me tell this. Balbiani is a scientist. This Balbiani will find out says different kind of chromosomes in Drosophila melanogaster. Now what is that? Drosophila melanogaster, here's the solution, but let me explain it to all of you. Balbiani is a scientist and he will find a special type of chromosome, that is polytene chromosomes in Drosophila melanogaster. So Balbiani rings are found in polytene chromosomes. It is a band-like structure. Let me show it to you. Let me call this as a chromosome. Okay. So if I'm calling this as a chromosome, this has some rings like this, which we actually call it as band in the chromosome. In Drosophila melanogaster, we call it as rings. So these rings, we call it as Balbiani rings. And this is found in polytene chromosome. So this is what you have to understand. This is the chromosome, the one which is red color, and the blue color are the Balbiani rings. So it is generally found in polytene chromosome. So Balbiani is a scientist name. Yeah. I'll read the Lydia, am I audible to you? Okay, Balbiani rings are the temporary swellings in the polytene chromosomes having uncoiled active DNA that transcribes RNA. I think it is the way, and solution is in the way more detailed. Okay. Well, I hope it is clear. Should I explain this question for one more time? Balbiani rings. Please be fast. Please say yes or no at least. Okay, Balbiani is a scientist name and he will find this rings in the polytene chromosomes. Polytene chromosomes are only present in Drosophila melanogaster. I'm repeating it for one more time. Please listen carefully. Polytene chromosomes are present in Drosophila melanogaster. And the polyteam chromosome, say for example, let me show it to you in the form of drawing. Say for example, this is the mid centromere. Say this is how the polyteam chromosomes are there. So if you can just check with the picture, like this is how the polyteam chromosomes will be there. Okay, this is how the polyteam chromosomes are there. Now what I'm going to do, this Balbiani rings are some kind of swelling. Say for example, this is a chromosome. This ring, which was like this, this is a chromosome, no? This, there is a swelling here. Can you see now? So this is a kind of a swelling. So that kind of things, it was actually explained by a scientist called as Balbiani, and that is why we are calling it as Balbiani chromosomes. Have you all understood now? Okay, we'll go back to the next third question. Third question. In DNA helix, cytosine is paired with guanine by how many hydrogen bonds? So now I'm going to unmute all of you. You have to please tell the answer. Yes.
Three.
How many hydrogen bonds?
Three hydrogen bonds.
Very good. What are the other students doing? Am I audible to all of you?
Three
hydrogen bonds. Very good. And cytosine is paired with guanine by three hydrogen bonds. What about adenine is paired with, how many hydrogen bonds?
Two.
Very good. Shall we move on to the next question now?
Yes, sir.
Is the only student answer? I want all the students to answer. Am I audible or is there any problem?
No, sir.
Shall I go to the first question?
Yes, sir.
Let me go with the fourth question. No. Which RNA picks up specific amino acid from amino acid? Okay, the question is very simple. See, which RNAs pick up specific amino acid from amino acid choline cytoplasm to ribosome during protein synthesis? Protein synthesis technical name is called as transcription or
translation.
Very good. Protein synthesis technical term is called as translation. Now, this is a specific tRNA which will help in the transfer of amino acid. The name itself, it is
telling.
tRNA. How is this? It is helping out.
The current amino acid.
Am I audible to all of you? Because I can only make out one to two voices. What are the other students doing? Have you understood the answer to this? Shall I go to the fifth question?
Yes, sir.
Yes. No. Let me come to the fifth question. The structure of DNA. Okay, you can answer this question.
Double helix.
Linear, double helix, single helix, triple helix. Which is the correct answer?
Double helix.
Double helix. Very good.
Double helix.
Yes. DNA is a double helical structure. Who gave this structure?
Crick
and
Watson and Crick.
Yes, Watson and Crick. Shall I go to the sixth question now? Is that clear? Fifth question?
Yeah.
Okay. transposon, I think this is a new concept. Let me explain this transposon to all of you. See, transposon is basically called as jumping gene. You please make a note of it. Transposon is called as jumping gene. And it is only found, it is only present in maize. I'm repeating it for one more time. Transposon is called as jumping gene and it is only found in the maize. Now, what is the main role of this? What is this jumping gene basically? Say, for example, there are some genetic material which is present in the cytoplasm, and also there are some genetic materials which is present in the nucleus. So, what is this genes are doing? The genes which are present in the cytoplasm will jump to the nucleus, and the genes present in the nucleus will jump into the cytoplasm. So these kind of genes which jump from one place to the other place or one membrane to the other membrane, we actually call it as transposon. And this transposon was explained by, do you have any idea for this question? Who's that scientist? Okay. Transposon was discovered by McClintock. Yes, McClintock will discover this thing called as transposon, and which is regarded as the jumping gene. Please make a note of it. Clintock, McClintock is regarded as Lady Mendel. I'm repeating it for one more time. McClintock is regarded as Lady Mendel. I hope it is clear for all of you. Should I repeat it for one more time? Chat section here. Okay. Please reply pa if you have any doubts in this question. If you have doubts, you please reply yes. Along with that, what is the doubt? If no, you please tell it us no. We'll go on to the next question. Okay. What is the other name for McClintock? You have to please answer it in the chat section. What is the other name for McClintock? Lady Mendel. Very good. Okay. We'll go to the seventh question now. It's okay. I'll read the seventh question. The root cell of wheat has 42 chromosomes. What would be the number of chromosomes in the synergid cell? Can you try answering for this? I'll just give you a minute of time. Please answer for this. Root cell of wheat has 42 chromosomes. What would be the number of chromosomes in the synergid cell? Okay. Now you please reply. In the chat section, you reply. The synergid is haploid or diploid or triploid. You just tell. Synergid is haploid or diploid or triploid? Synergid is haploid or diploid or triploid? Okay. Synergid is the haploid condition. I'm telling it. Synergid is the haploid condition. So 42 is 2N. So what will be the synergid number of chromosomes? You please reply in the chat section. Make it fast. How it is 28? What is 42 divided by 2? Yes. What is the correct answer now? 21 is the correct answer. Why 21? Because root cell is diploid. That is 42. 2N. What is N is equal to? So N is equal to 42 by 2. That is 21. Is this question clear for all of you? You can just read the solution. Is it done? Do you have any doubts regarding the seventh question? Please say yes or no. Do you have any doubts regarding this question? Okay, we'll move on to the next one. Question number 8, I think all of you can answer this. I want all of you to answer for this. Okazaki fragments form leading strand, lagging strand, nonsense strand, senseful strand. Please reply fastly. We'll see who will reply first. Read the question. And please answer to the question. Let me check who will reply first. Make it fast. Only I have got two answers. Yes, Okazaki fragments are formed in the lagging strand. As I have already told in the synopsis point, there are two strands which are formed at the end of the DNA replication. One would be leading strand and the other would be the lagging strand. So leading strand has the continuous strand and the lagging strand has some discontinuous strands, and it is termed as the fragments, which we generally call it as Okazaki fragments. So now there's an announcement. Please listen. The session is going to end and I want all of you to rejoin to the same ID. As soon as the session ends, please rejoin for the same ID. I will get back to you.